Hey guys, welcome to the CoLab podcast. My name is Ryan McPherson. I'm CEO and co-founder at CoAssemble. We're revolutionizing the online training platform for small to medium businesses in the B2B space. And today I'm super excited to have Alon Shkri on with me today, talking about how NextSales helps B2B businesses and companies sell digitally, scale sales enablement for their customers, and also leverage huge amounts of video and online training in doing so. So Alon, welcome to the CoLab podcast. Super excited to have you on board. Let's dive in, shall we? Tell me a little bit about you, your company, and a little bit of history on who you are and what you're bringing to the business.
Yeah, of course. First of all, thank you for having me, Ryan. So a little bit about myself. I started I think 12 years ago when I finished the military service in Israel, as we are an Israeli-based company. And I was looking to, what am I going to do now? You know, I finished the army. What are going to be my next steps? It was a big journey for me. So I started my own digital agency.
That's a jump right there. That's a different story right there. We'll have to dig into a little bit more of that.
So I'm kind of I do things differently. Even if they tell me this is the way to do it, I have to do it differently. It's something in my blood. I have to do things differently. So everybody was going for a job, you know, just work somewhere to get some money and to save something. But I was let's deep dive, go straight into it. So I did it for a couple of years, and I have to say, I made tons of mistakes. Like all the mistakes you could make, I made them. But that's eventually the best lesson, you know. That's the best way to learn. Sorry for that. To make mistakes and to learn by mistakes. So I did that for a couple of years, and then I finally made a jump to sales. My first sales role. I went to work for a B2C financial a company in the financial sector. Okay. And I started out as a sales rep. And after 1 month, I reached my target. They were very happy with me. I was also very happy with the salary as a sales guy. You know how it goes with targets and those kind of things. And then they offered me a job to open a franchise in the Netherlands, as I'm originally from the Netherlands, and to start my own franchise. So I said, why not? Sounds interesting. Let's do it.
Let's do it. I like that attitude. I like that approach that you have. Yeah.
Thanks. So I went to the Netherlands, totally new for me. I didn't have any experience with, doing something in the financial sector, having my own sales company. But I, the same as with the digital agency, I just deep dived, and I managed to really build up a company of 20 salespeople in 3 years. Was very successful. Thanks. And that's how I started my sales career. I did it for 3 years there, very intense. Every day in, day out, just only sales. And until
just
my
just putting the deals away day in, day out. That's what exactly that's what good sales guys and good sales ladies do. Yeah,
exactly. So that's about the job at the financial sector. Then my wife, she's Israeli, and she was not really used to the weather in the Netherlands. It's raining and no sun. So she said, let's go back to Israel. I miss the sun. So I had to go back. You have to listen to your wife, otherwise you won't make it.
A very important tip right there. Yeah, absolutely.
So I listened to her. We went back to Israel 2 years ago. And then at the same time, my brother, my older brother, he's 12 years older. He also did the same move as I did. He had a company, a B2C, B2B consulting company in the IT sector. And he also moved from the Netherlands to Israel.
Okay.
So we were both in the same situation. We're thinking what is going to be our next step? And it was kind of difficult because there's a big mental move to go from the Netherlands to Israel, whole different mentality, different vibe, different kind of things. And then he had, in specific, had a big challenge of how he could be close with his customers and clients when working from such a distance. That was his biggest challenge.
Okay.
And that was even before the corona happened.
Mm-hmm.
So we were talking about it, how can we fix that? You know, as salespeople, there shouldn't be anything bothering us. We just should, reach our targets or close those deals or build relationships or build trust. It should work even when we work from distance. So we were looking at all kind of solutions, what we could do. And then we both saw something about video selling. I don't know if you are familiar with it.
Yeah, I've seen a little bit of it, and I've got a couple of our team members also utilizing a little bit of it. But yeah, I'd love to hear more about it.
Okay, so cool. So yeah, we're both like very excited about the concept of video selling. We didn't have any experience with it, of course. So then we just said, you know, we have to do something with the whole digital selling. And video selling was just a start for us to get into that world of digital selling.
Okay.
But then the whole concept of the next sale started. Just started our journey by just doing it instead of, you know, writing the whole plan and thinking about it. Because then
you can got in there and made some videos.
Exactly, make some videos. So that's what we did, and we. I can tell you like a little bit of a fun story, like how we got in touch with how we experienced the video selling ourselves. That my brother said, like he's my older brother, so you know, I'm kind of also when he says something, I kind of I have to listen. So he said, like Alon, you know, we have to look for a platform where you can host those videos, and we can send those videos as you use a platform with animated GIFs and the whole. You can track and trace the videos. You know a little bit about it.
Yeah.
So I signed up for like, I don't know, 10, maybe 20 platforms. Mm-hmm. I guess I'm familiar how it works on the SaaS.
It's a process. Yeah, you got to try and you know go through the process of testing the software and.
Exactly. But the thing was, everything looks the same. You know, like everybody says the same things. This website had a little bit of a different color. They say a little bit different slogans. But at the end, I was like, what is the difference between this company and this company? So my brother said, like, we have to look at all the requirements that we need. Like, we need an integration with this. We need these and these features. And we need, I don't know, some more stuff. So I was like, okay, I will fix it. So I signed up for some platforms. And suddenly, out of nowhere, I got a personalized video from also a guy from Australia. Pretty funny, because you guys are also in Australia, right?
Yes, correct. Yes. Yeah. Started out of Australia. Yeah.
So he sent me a personalized video. That was the first video I got. And I was like flabbergasted. He said I was like totally in shock that he sounds kind of funny, but like he said my name and it was like a just very authentic video. He was also in his garden. I saw kind of parrots flying around and I have to say, I didn't even understand what he was saying. He has such an Australian accent.
I only understand my name. Like
I can understand you better than that guy. But but the thing is that he made such an emotional connection with me by just making something for me that I just threw away all the requirements and I just wanted to go with that platform. And then I saw the power. I saw the power of personalization and video and those kind of stuff. So. Mm-hmm. That's where it all started for us to start with digital selling, video selling, and a little bit about myself.
Yeah, very cool. And with the next sales, what's the story behind it? Who do you work with? What do you do? You know, what's the secret sauce? You know, why would we think about using the next sales?
So, like I said, we help B2B companies, digital sales teams, or sales teams to go digital. To build trust faster, because it's getting really difficult for sales teams to build trust the old way. As you know, prospects, you don't get their attention, you know, very easy. As also there was done a study by HubSpot that there are even more emails being sent out since the COVID pandemic started. So how can you stand out? And even when you stand out, how can you get the attention? And even when you get the attention, how can you keep the attention? So it's a whole new world of doing everything online.
And it's interesting you talk a lot about trust and building trust. And it sounds like that's a big piece of your business and ensuring that the sales teams that work with the next sales understand how to build trust digitally, which maybe they've done face-to-face in the past or at meetings or, you know, face-to-face coffee. Now they're having to do that digitally and that might look very different,
Exactly. That's exactly the point. And it's way more difficult to do because when you have like a coffee with somebody, first of all, he can't go nowhere. So you're with him in the same space and it's just a chit chat, you know, but when somebody is at a Zoom call or the Google Meet, whatever it is, and sometimes you don't even put on his camera, you know, so he can be even, I don't know, putting you on mute, playing with his children, making some food and he's not
listening. Not really listening. Yeah. Yeah, and I think we've seen some funny videos and funny, you know, funny things going on in the meeting space, and people accidentally unmuting themselves at a different time. So I guess, you know, this whole new digital world that we now live in this camera world and this connection via kind of live experiences, but through the computer screen, I guess it's a good opportunity for you to really carve out a business, and it sounds like you've done that. So who do you work with? What are some of the businesses or types of businesses that you're working with? Large sales teams, small sales teams, you know, tech-based companies, non-tech-based companies. I'm keen to understand who exactly does the Next Sales really work with.
So we mainly focus on IT companies. And it is funny to say that when we started, we thought that we should target like the smaller companies, even startups, because we thought like, you know, they wanted to adopt change the most as they need to grow. Yes. But we saw exactly the opposite, like the biggest companies, they wanted to be to make the change. And the smaller companies didn't want to do any change. So that was kind of
interesting finding.
Yeah, really interesting. So we work mainly with like medium, large companies. We have some enterprise as well. And sales teams going from, let's say, 5 sales teams to 40, 60 salespeople. And we not only help them with video selling, but it's the whole concept of building trust online. Like we have kind of a methodology to do it. And it's also like social selling, how to approach somebody. It's about listening and giving and adding value, those kind of stuff. Now you can mix it, how you can do it the right way with video or without video, it doesn't really matter. And storytelling, referral selling, all those kind of stuff make a big part of digital selling.
And so I guess a lot of your business is a little bit of educating. So you're really coming in and saying, hey, you might not know how to do this. Maybe we can help you with your strategy. Maybe we can help you with the technology that you're using. So a lot of, I guess, what you're working with is coaching, mentoring, educating essentially teams on how to think about digitally selling that may not have thought about it before, but you're also putting it into practice. So I assume that they get results out of this. So where does it all start? Talk me through an experience for a customer. Is it a work with the sales team straight away? Is it work more with the business first? How does the next sales process start to get into a business and start to affect behavior change, which drives more sales, I assume?
Yeah, a good one. It's of course the goal when you want to teach something. It's not to say thanks for having the information and I won't do anything with it, because that that's what happens a lot. You know, people learn something but they don't do anything with it. So especially with salespeople, it's really difficult to change their habits, because if I may say this, maybe I have to say it a little bit quietly. Salespeople are a little bit lazy and they don't want to change.
It can be process driven, I think, is what they're very, very in a process, and sometimes can get stuck into that process. And I guess it's one of those roles where you are doing a similar task day in, day out. You're sending leads, emails, you're having meetings, you're talking pricing, you're talking the product. So you can see how that repetitive nature sometimes might breed a resistance to change.
Yeah, exactly. So they are very busy with their own targets, their own schedule. So it was in the beginning when we started, because we're just our company just exists like 1.5 years. So also here we made some mistakes. We thought like it should work this way, and it didn't work out this way. So we adapted and we adjusted like how we could do this the other way. So basically, how we start is that we get first of all a buy-in from the management team. Because if they don't believe in it and if they don't want to support it internally, then it just won't work.
Always important. So
that's the first thing that we do. And then they also have to decide what the KPIs are going to be, because there are some new KPIs, like, for example, making videos, how much of your videos are being watched, or how much, I don't know, new connections you made on LinkedIn, whatever they want to make as a KPI.
Yeah, and The metrics have certainly changed, haven't they? So it used to be, you know, how many calls you might make a day, or how many meetings you might have, for example. But now it's a little bit more, you know, how many people have watched my video, how many HubSpot flows worked, and very much based around technology and CRMs and, you know, really looking at that funnel,
Exactly. So that really changed. And one of the things that we really focus on is, like, sales are already always focused on the deal, you know, on the, and they sometimes a lead just as a lead, as a number, you know. So this is lead number 253, I have to close it. But at the end, it's about having a conversation. Like, that's the real deal. So when you have a conversation with somebody, eventually it will flow. You can add some value. You can have another conversation. You build trust. And at the end of that trust building, of course, a deal is something that will come on the road.
Naturally. Yeah. Naturally. So I think more recently, I want to talk to you about this. We've seen education start to play a role in sales, and it becomes more of a role where, you know, that conversation, I'm adding value. I might be teaching you something about my product, and you might be asking me some questions you had around using our product. But really, as you say, I love that you lead with, starts with a conversation, right? And that conversation can spiral into an opportunity. If the salesperson can see the opportunity, then often there is a deal available. And so I think sales has changed a lot from, you know, I want to sell you on the features to really, I want to help you understand how to use that product, and it starts with the conversation. So I want to kind of flip to CoAssemble a little bit and your journey there. It sounds like education plays a big part in your business. And what I mean by education is obviously teaching skills, you know, mentoring those skills, adjusting different teams and coming in and really trying to make a behavior change, right? So something that really drives performance, but is done through a way of kind of changing the way that they approach something. So what was the aha moment for you to start thinking about tools that would help you educate these teams, I guess, and where did that all start, and what was that journey like?
First of all, I totally agree with you with what you said. I see it the same way. And when we started to think about a tool that we should use, it was that just before COVID, we gave an offline workshop. We fly Netherlands, and then COVID started, and then we're like, okay, workshops are out. We can't do that anymore, so we have to do it differently.
You started face-to-face. You're thinking, yep, we'll get there. We'll do a face-to-face session. And then obviously COVID in 2020 changes the game for a lot of people in this space, very similar. So you look to an online tool, yeah?
Yeah. And for us, it was also because we were doing everything digitally. So you could say, why wouldn't you start digitally also with learning? But, you know, when you do it digitally, you have to build all the content. And when you're just a young company with 2 or 3 people, then investing in the content before even investing to get some clients, then we really believe that it starts with getting clients first and only then build the content, because otherwise you're building something that might not be relevant for them.
Yep. And so it sounds like you were able to build some of your solutions and your education off experience with customers. Yeah. So it wasn't necessarily pre-planned. It was probably built organically as you went through the process. And something we talk a lot about at CoAssemble is building content, designing content. Where do you start? For a lot of our listeners, they're wondering, you know, where do I start? How do I start? And, you know, it wouldn't be the first time that we've heard someone like yourself say, well, rather than pre-plan it and pre-create it, we actually used our customers to help us build content that was going to be meaningful. So I'd love to hear more about that process.
I have to say that you guys at CoAssemble really do what you say, like, because that's also one of the reasons, just to go a little bit off topic, that we chose for CoAssemble is that I saw that you guys are really dynamically and also listening to what your clients are looking for. Because all the other companies, they are maybe, if I might say this, also a little bit bigger. So they're like, we have the money, we're just looking to scale. And if you need a feature, just, I don't know, go to someone
else. Yeah. CoAssemble is a little bit more organic. We're still building out our story. And so we're willing to absolutely listen and make sure that we've got the right type of technology for you guys out there that are really looking to change their business as well.
But I really believe in that, because eventually when you're making something as an entrepreneur, you think that this is the exact solution, but at the end, you're not selling it to yourself, you're selling it to your client. So if they don't like it, then what can you do with it? So we also started with asking clients, okay, what are you looking for? What are your challenges? What are you facing? What problems are you facing? Yeah. And then we started having more conversations and just getting those little details, like, you know, a little bit more this, a little bit less that. And that's how we eventually got what we have now, like a whole program of all kind of stuff.
Yeah. And what was the first course about? Was it about, you know, video selling? Was it more about the process working with you guys? Or was it more about leads and how to talk to them and how to conversate? You know, what was that first course? Where did it come from?
Like why our clients would want to work with the next sales, you mean?
No, just what was your first course? What did you make first in CoAssemble?
The first course, I understand. First course was about video selling, because we did it a lot. So it was just a video selling course. And I have to say that when I look back at now at the first course, I kind of feel like, how could they pay for this? You know, it wasn't, but it's always like that. When you keep improving, you think like what you've done like a year before, it doesn't look good. Of course, it was worth something, but now, you know, you keep improving. So we rebuild it again, and we just build another course, a new course. Okay. But I have to say that people were very enthusiastic also about the first course, that it inspired them to do something. And also a lot of people, they just did the course and they didn't do anything with it. So that's where we wanted to fine tune and look for why didn't they adopt and why didn't they take
the
change.
I love that, yeah. So important that if you're going to create a course and you're going to want to try and see behavior change, you're going to really sell the concept that, hey, we can help you with video selling, do our course, and then you see people do the course and not change, then you'd be like, what happened? So I love that you were able to kind of analyze that, look for that feedback loop to make sure that this course was actually delivering exactly on the purpose of the course. And I assume you can change CoAssemble so easily, you were able to kind of move that along over time. Yeah, so the course improves.
Yeah, that doing it the CoAssemble was very easy to change it a little bit. And we made it so for one of the things that we did, like in the course, we used a lot of video because we're doing video selling, only video, video, video.
But makes sense.
It makes kind of sense. But at the end, we saw that we wanted to use more dynamic content because also here, when you want to keep the attention, if it's always the same thing, so you click on the next module, you see another video, another video. So you can call it micro learning, but if it's one big video chunked into 30 small, then it's just one big video for them. So we also play with that dynamics of, because you have a lot of nice modules of
presentation templates and quiz templates and really trying to get, you know, learners engaged. So it's great to hear that you kind of adjusted the course based on what you were seeing. Was the reporting really important in seeing, you know, how many people were completing it or where they were getting stuck? How much did you use the analytics and the report side of the platform?
We used it pretty much for every time because we also give workshops after the course. Yep. So then we would see like, okay, who engaged with the course, who didn't engage? Yeah. And then we'd go further from there.
Cool. And what was the aha moment to say that this is working? You know, was there a change in your business where you said, wow, this is really actually making a difference? Were you sold on it straight away, or did you kind of have to prove it out over time? Did everyone love it initially, or, you know, what was the experience like in that first 12 months?
So the aha moment was when, of course, we had a lot of people on our platform. And they were, it was kind of funny because people say like, yeah, I love this video selling and it really, I really believe it should help and blah, blah, blah. And then they go back to work and don't do anything with video selling. So I was like, you know, you like it, but you don't do anything with it. So we had some people that they really did something with it and they just learned everything online. We did some workshops offline, like online, but off topic.
Yeah, a blended approach. Yeah, it's pretty common. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then they saw some success. So one of the sales reps, she sent a video, totally cold to one of her prospects, and then she got a meeting from it. And then we really started to see like the end result. Because if you learn something and you want to see the end result that, okay, I learned how to do this. Mm-hmm. Like, let's do it. And then he does it. And then it works for him. And then you feel like you make the round, the circle, like it finishes like, you know, it works. What we've done, like, where we started, this is what we wanted to reach when we teach somebody this skill.
Would you say at the moment, forgetting CoAssemble necessarily, but, you know, for your business, obviously, where you are training and mentoring and trying to produce, I guess, a result back in the business where sales team members get more sales, how closely are you able to align the training that you're doing, whether it's blended or online, back to the results in the business? I assume that that's what management really starts to ask you guys. So, you know, hey, we've paid for these courses and we've gone through them and the team have loved them. I want to now see some more sales, right? So I assume, so talk us through how do you do that? How do you look at that that connection, I guess, between the two?
So that's a good question. As in the beginning, when we were selling our solution, we're just talking about results, you know. So the management, let's say the management would say, okay, I would buy this course, I would invest in it. And so you train the people, but what can you offer me as a promise, as a result? And that's, of course, a difficult promise to make because it's not in our hands, you know. They should do the work. Mm-hmm. They should the videos and all those kind of stuff. So That was in the beginning a little bit difficult for us, but then we switched it and we said, listen, the only KPI that you should manage in the beginning is not the result, it's just the activity. So don't go for, how many deals did I get? Go for how many videos did your sales rep
make. Yeah. And we assume that if video selling works and the training has worked, then that video, the more videos they send, then obviously the more sales that they'll probably get down the track. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Very cool. What's your favorite course? You know, what is the one that you built or the company learned, you know, was the greatest asset for the business so far? You know, what was it about? Was it video selling potentially? Was it another course that come along later? You know, what's been the best experience so far?
The best course for us would be a social selling course where we talk about, it's a philosophy that we have, like a mindset. We call it the trust mindset, mm-hmm. where it's about four human ingredients, about listening, giving, receiving, and eventually building trust. So that's like, you always have to keep in mind when you do sales, that I see it a lot when salespeople reach out to somebody, they just want to pitch. And in the beginning, it's all about listening. You know, you have to listen, like, does your client really want? And sometimes it's even about listening without even thinking about what is my solution going to be. Because sometimes you listen and you think like, okay, I listen, but what I'm going to say next, you know? But sometimes you just have to listen. Mm-hmm. So the whole social selling concept is just about those simple human ingredients, listening, giving, receiving, and eventually building trust. So we build a course about it, how you can do that.
And I'm interested, how long was the course? Is it a short course? Is it a long course? Is it something that that takes weeks or days? And what was the kind of material that you had in there? Was it a lot of video? Is it you talking? Is it more kind of worksheets and, you know, or using some of our templates, quizzes? I'm just curious, like, what does that course look like?
So we have a real, like, mix mm-hmm. of all kind of stuff. We have, like, quizzes, videos, presentation templates like you have in Coassemble. But the main thing that we make a difference is that we, because we saw that when you explain something on video, and let's say I'm talking to you and I'm explaining something for 2 minutes and you just see me talking, it kind of gets boring. You know, people think like, even if they hear me, they think like, I think about something else. Yeah, think about something else, exactly. So what we did, we put everything in like kind of a scenario-based learning. We created scenarios that, for example, me and one of my colleagues, we play like a sales scenario. That I'm the prospect and she's the sales saleswoman. And then you can feel like you can also see it's like more realistic, relevant, and relatable for you, that you can feel like, you know, and it gets your attention because you don't know what's coming next.
So scenario learning has always been very popular, especially to provide context and realism to the situation. And a lot of people think about those scenarios. They can relate to those scenarios. They may have been in one of those scenarios. So, for example, if I'm selling you Coassemble and I try and pitch price too early, you know, and you say, hey, I wasn't ready to talk price. I'm just investigating the feature set. Or, you know, you can really use some of those scenarios and guide people down pathways. And you can do that online, you know, quite successfully. I'm keen to know, how do you see Coassemble or a learning tool like Coassemble in your business? Do you see it as one of the other tools that you have? Do you see it as a main driving force that helps you drive revenue? Where does it sit at the moment? Because I think there's a lot of our listeners out there that would be saying, yeah, I like the idea of using education, you know, in my business. I like the idea of courses to maybe drive revenue into a different new product or something like that, but I'm just not sure if it's going to work. So I'm just curious, how do you guys now see our type of tool, I guess, or the learning type of tool in your business?
For us, it's really important, as the whole business is kind of based on a learning experience, which is, on one hand, it's Coassemble, and we other have like workshops that we give it also online digitally, but different than just a Zoom call. I don't know if you know it. There's a platform called pitch.com. You've heard about it, maybe?
Right, yeah, okay. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It's also very cool when you can, but okay, let's talk about Coassemble. So, it's very important for us and also for our clients, because we also set up an environment for every client that we have. We also put them on Coassemble. And yeah,
And I did want to talk to you about this. So you've been able to use CoAssemble, and the team often talk about how cool, you work with so many different third-party platforms and technologies, and some of the companies that have come in and used CoAssemble off the back of yourself and your company have done some really cool stuff, innovative and fun stuff. So talk to me about how you've kind of branched out, how every customer has their own space, and you've been able to brand those spaces, I guess, and it's really become almost a selling feature for you, yeah?
Yeah, exactly. So most of the companies, they have somebody that is that his domain is learning, then some of them, they don't even have a LMS or something. So if you have to sell them to get somebody to get to know the LMS and to design everything, then it might be, we'll do it later or we'll do it never. That's what they eventually say. So we do the whole process for them. We design it. We build the structure, the flow. And it's very easily done with the CoAssemble, that we can copy paste the whole workplace into another one, change some colors.
Very scalable.
Very scalable and super, super easy to do. That works perfectly for us. And in relate to using other tools as well and putting it in CoAssemble, that's really the magic for us. For example, when we use VideoAsk, I don't know if you know VideoAsk.
Yes, yeah, we saw. And I know that the team are always very excited to use you guys as an example, where you're really trying to push the boundaries on. CoAssemble can be the structural home of the content and the experience, but we can bring in so many cool tools. And VideoAsk by Typeform, for example, I know the company and I know the example really, really well. Just for our listeners, is this example where you can send a video to someone in kind of like an asynchronous conversation, and they can reply in video, and you can have a full conversation that's not live, but and you guys have been able to put that into CoAssemble. I know there's a number of other tools that you've used, and we love that you guys are pushing those boundaries. So where does that come from? Do you just explore? Do you just try? Do you have just ideas and just say, hey, let's see what happens? So talk us through the experience of really trying to push CoAssemble to its boundaries.
Like I said, when I started, I like to do things differently, so I think if you guys had an integration with VideoAsk, I would find another platform. That's how I am. Yeah. I just do everything differently. So the where it started with VideoAsk is that we saw it really helped, as we also, when we start the course, we also do an assessment first. So before sending some salespeople to a course, we first do a assessment on VideoAsk. We send them some questions, like, for example, they reply, for example, do you like the concept of video selling? We explain a little bit, and then they say, okay, from 1 to 10, how much do you like it? They say 9. Then we say, okay, how much time do you want to invest, from 1 to 10, or, I don't know, 3 hours, 5 hours, and they can choose. And then they pitch themselves to do the course, because it's very different when you say that your salespeople have to do the course instead of they saying to themselves that I have to do the course.
Yeah, I love that that thinking about trying to set up the course, and making sure that you've fully got the learner, the person who's going to undertake the course, on board, right? And you're doing that through questions. But then again, on top of that, you're using a really cool technology inside our technology even to do that at a higher level. That's such a cool idea. I know that obviously in the past we've seen customers use Intercom, for example, live chat in our platform to do that as well. It's great to see that there's new technologies like VideoAsk out there as well. What does the future of like online training or online education look like at NextSales? What are you looking to do next? What's the big picture here? Where are you going to take your online training for these customers?
That's a good question. We want to keep improving, and we more want to create like a discussion to more like, it shouldn't be just us selling, telling guys how to do it. We also want to hear their voice of what they think should work and not. And that's also, if I can come back to VideoAsk, we use it in the course. So let's say we have a video in the course, and at the end of the video, we say, for example, what is your thought on this one? And then they have a button inside the video. They click on it. They go to VideoAsk, and then they can just say what they think.
So you're really able to start to bring a live component, or really engaging kind of conversational component to the online training space, using CoAssemble and some other cool tools like VideoAsk. I'm just curious, what were some of the challenges? Just tell me, where did you fall over? Was creating your first course really hard? Were you not sure where to start, or rolling out your courses? were there any challenges, or did you find it pretty simple?
I have to say that I tried some other platforms that was kind of challenging, because and I will give a compliment to CoSambo in a few seconds, that when I tried other platforms, when you see the website, you see the website before you see the platform, everything seems nice. But then when you log in and you see the platform, it looks like a Nokia, when you know, remember the Nokia
with school.
The
snake? Yeah.
Oh, cool. Yeah. So, and then, you know, you see like it looks like a cock pilot, how do you say it? Like for a pilot when he has
very,
like,
very complex. Yeah, very complex. Yeah.
Very complex. So that didn't work out for us. And then when we started with CoSambo, it was like so simple. So you have like the templates that you can use, like a resource, explore resources. You get a template. Mm-hmm. You just play with it a little bit. You see what you're going to make. Mm-hmm. And it's like, of course, the user experience and the design is also really amazing, I have to say.
And I want to touch on that. So a lot of our customers, they do buy us because we are pretty and we are kind of easy to use and simple. But also on the learner side, I assume for your sales teams who are also learning, you know, they don't want to have to learn a new technology to learn, right? They actually want to just get in there and see the content and engage with the content. And you want that to be as simple as possible as well. So have you found that your learners, your sales team members who are buying the courses and going through it, have they had a great experience on the other side?
They had a great experience, yeah. Mm. They had a great experience. Like I said, design is very important for maybe, I think, all of our clients and for ourselves as well. And that makes eventually the experience. So
yeah.
Also cool. Like people like Apple, like an iPhone, in my opinion, it's all about the design, you know?
Like my design wife leads to
crazy about the iPhone, but she doesn't know anything instead of WhatsApp, you know? You also have WhatsApp and Instagram and all the other phones, but she just likes the iPhone.
Fair enough. The design wins over. For our audience, just, you know, what are some tips and tricks to starting this process in your business? You know, what would you say to people to think about, or are there any tricks to get through? You know, you've gone through it now, you've built out a great business. CoSambo might be assisting you, but really what you're using is online education to drive revenue, to drive your business itself, and really use it as a powerful asset inside your business. So I'm curious, is there any tips you'd give to other business owners, entrepreneurs out there who are thinking, I like the idea of potentially educating my customers, not sure where to start, not sure what to do. Any advice from your experience?
I can say that like eventually every company has to do something with e-learning. They have to, to teach their employees something, because if they don't do it in the long term, especially now when people work remotely and you can't, you know, have those fun days at the office, so you have to give some other value, and teaching them something is like one of those values. So eventually you have to do it, but if you think about like how can I nail it from the moment I start with it, then you would never do it. So
yeah,
what I suggest, just start.
And take that first step.
Take that first step, and that's the same what we did as well. And CoSambo is like a great partner in that one, because they, first of all, have a really easy user experience. It's like really easy to build courses. And the second thing that we really like, that you guys keep on involving every month or quarter, new updates, listening to clients, what they want. Customer support is amazing if you need some help. I think I know the whole thing there already. So,
you've probably had many conversations, many questions. I'm not sure we always nail it, but we try and talk to all our customers, because I think, just like you've said at the start of this call, you know, building trust, talking to your customers, having that conversation often drives more opportunities. And we know that, you know, our customers are growing in our tool. They're just starting out. They're not always 100% sure where they're heading. And we often talk about it's really at CoSambo with one course, because if you can trust us to try us with one course, generally, eventually, you'll probably have 55 or 60 courses. So I love that you guys have that starting thinking about, like, let's just get started and let's see where this ends. And it sounds like it's really driving your business now, which is great.
Yeah, because if you don't do it, you will lose more by not doing it than what you will lose by, instead of getting it a 10 out of 10, you get just a 6 out of 10. It's still better than not doing anything.
Well, I want to thank you for your time. We're out of time here, Alan, but it's been amazing talking to you. Just in summary, it sounds like, you know, the business for you is educating and mentoring and coaching. You've got a blended approach to do that. You've started by thinking about how customers could engage in your content. You've kind of taken that on board, built out courses with their feedback in mind as you've gone through, and you've done that in a way that really is quite innovative, using different technologies to really think about the learner journey and making sure, as you've said a couple of times today, that the course actually has behavioral change. It actually makes a difference in that salesperson's day, which hopefully leads to better results. And, you know, you started with video selling, you know, and really kind of branched out to social selling. And it sounds like, you know, CoAssemble will be a big part of your future. I just want to thank you for your time today and being on the CoLab podcast. Always great to hear entrepreneurs just pushing the boundaries on how to use education in their business to drive results. And so congratulations on that. Just closing up here, to stay current with the latest trends of online training, employee experience, and how to grow your team at scale, click subscribe or follow along to the CoLab podcast. Just like the next sales here, you can use online training in your business to drive real performance results. And Alan, it was amazing having you on board today. Any final comments to lead us off today?
Just try it out. Try it out.
I love it.
That's it.
Just do it. Nike. Almost. Appreciate your time. All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Ryan.